We have records of Native Americans fishing these species. About 30 of these species that show up in Indian middens. They fish them with spears, hooks, and weirs, going back to 2500 BC. So the Great Lakes have been supplying fish for people for a very long time. In the 17th and 18th centuries, settlers from Europe fished Atlantic salmon in Lake Ontario, and that started the big changes in the Great Lakes. So going through some of these other dates quickly, in 1825 and 33, the Erie and Welland Canals bypassed Niagara Falls for shipping, and of course that allowed a lot of fish to move up into the upper Great Lakes. 1834 to 36, commercial fishing began, and that was another big change. 1850s up to 1860, the Lake Ontario Atlantic salmon were completely destroyed by overfishing, but also by pollution from lumbering and agriculture. And I think people don't appreciate how early this destruction of Great Lakes fishes started. So as early as 1860, the drop in abundance of Great Lakes fishes, especially those that people were depending upon for food, was so serious that Michigan, with the help of the federal government, started fish hatcheries as the solution to the problem. And so, as you know, this is simply adding another layer of problems on the overfishing. So I've got several more of these to go. And the reason I put these together, and maybe as I go through this, you can see, I was trying to test the hypothesis that Richard Lewontin has brought up of trying to distinguish in environmental stories like this one, the difference between chaos and historical contingency. And I was looking to see whether there's some kind of a power function of the increase in the Great Lakes tragedies that we could see. I didn't see this, but as we go through this, maybe some of the rest of you will be able to spot this. Basically, what I've got is a list of bad things. In 1869, the first gillnet steamers on Lake Michigan increased the production of fish and, of course, caused the increasing decline of the fish populations. 1870s, fishers complained about fish destruction by log drives, pollution, and insecticides. In 1870s, partly as a response to the decline in the native fishes, carp, this is an Asian carp, our first Asian carp, were introduced to the Great Lakes. Alewives came in through the canals, and so the invasive species problems go back that far too. Now, also in the 1870s, not all the fishermen were blaming the destruction of the fish on logs and lumbering and pollution. Some of the fishers in Michigan actually went to the legislature and asked for legislative restrictions on the number of fishermen or the seasons or something to reduce the fishing pressure on the Great Lakes. Otherwise, they said, our kids will have no source of income. They won't have jobs. As some of you know, the legislature drew up rules, and then as it's described in the commission reports from the Great Lakes from the late 1870s, people characterized as people who never got their hands dirty stepped in and silenced the legislation so that the restrictions on overfishing were not passed, never came into existence. Later, when we have our discussion, I hope we can talk about why that would be. because I think it's part of the bigger picture of the problems with the Great Lakes. Oh, I'm sorry. In 1872, despite the fact that some of the fishermen were conservation minded, they figured out how to focus their fishing efforts on spawning populations, which just exacerbated the trend. In 1875, freezing and refrigeration on board enabled fishing 30 to 40 miles farther out than the fishermen were able to fish before. In 1881, gillnet tugs became important. So from 1885 on, we went from sailing ships, which of course gave the fish a little bit of a chance, to steam power. And the word at the time was, okay, now we've got nets by the mile and catch by the ton. In 1885, just in the western bay of Lake Erie, there were 888 licensed registered pound nets. These are big nets that attract fish in with wings that the fishermen can lift them out by the ton. But in the rest of the lakes, away from the pound nets, gill nets had become very popular, very important. Prior to this time, many of the gill nets were actually woven by the fishermen's wives, but manufactured gill nets came into the system so that by 1885, 5,300 miles of gill nets were being fished in the Great Lakes. That's a big, long bit of nets. I mean, it's, 4,800 miles from here to San Francisco. So it's almost to Hawaii. So the benchmark harvest in 1889 was 73,000 tons of fish per year. In the 1890s, the sea lampreys attacked Lake Whitefish in Lake Ontario and then started in on the fish at the Upper Great Lakes. because Lake Whitefish and Cisco's and Chubb's were no longer able to sustain the fishing pressure, fishermen for the first time really started to capture and market yellow perch, walleye, suckers, northern pike, in addition to the whitefish and lake trout. By then, hatcheries were distributing millions of fish per year. And this is still in the 1890s. One little item, in 1892, the records show that pound nets in Lake Erie captured many tons of blue pike, beautiful little blue relatives of walleyes, a separate species actually, that weighed about a half pound to a quarter pound each. Beautiful little fish. By the 1950s, when I first came to Michigan, the blue pike had just become extinct, were no longer available. So that was one of the first and most dramatic extinctions of a species unique to the Great Lakes. Through the 1880s and 90s, Lake Whitefish declined from 12,000 tons per year to 4,500 tons per year. Now, you might stop to wonder, well, where were all these fish going? They were all being marketed outside our area to, some to Chicago, that's in our area, but many to the East Coast.